When you think of composers, what is the first thing to come to mind? Perhaps this guy, or these ones, or a sharp gentleman in a black tailcoat wielding a thin baton in his hand, frustratingly trying to get a new orchestra to understand his vision. You may even think of modern film score composers, such as the legendary Hans Zimmer or John Williams. But what's missing from our traditional image of score composers? That's right, women. Though cries for more representation in Hollywood have yielded some results in the big screen, not as much progress is being made behind the curtain, especially when it comes to those who write the music. In fact, women in film in 2017 comprised only 3% of composers, with 98% of films featuring no female composers. TV scores share similar statistics. Out of 201 series produced or co-produced in the U.S. in the 2017-18 season, 11 feature a female composer, or 5.5%. According to the New York Times, for the top 100 fictional films at the box office every year from 2007 to 2017, only 16 female composers were hired, compared to more than 1,200 men. So why this lack in hiring female composers? One reason is rooted in our perceptions of the feminine and the masculine. Rachel Portman, the British composer who became the first woman to win an Academy Award for Best Musical or Comedy Score in 1996, has had filmmakers tell her she's not capable of writing tough music, that is, for action scenes or anything in a mode not stereotypically feminine. But even as shows and films starring strong female characters have increased recently, it's still largely men who are given the task of writing the score. Another key factor is Hollywood connections. Many filmmakers will form a type of informal partnership with score composers, rehiring them several times if the first collaboration went well. Steven Spielberg has famously worked with John Williams to write scores for all but 5 of his works. James Horner has worked with James Cameron on some of his most famous works. Tim Burton and Danny Elfman have collaborated a whopping 18 times, and many more examples exist. Female composers who are consistently underpaid and underhired have a substantially harder time forming such partnerships, making it harder to make a steady income off of composing. Female composers are overwhelmingly hired to work under male composers, and thus are systematically paid less. By placing female composers under their male counterparts, or giving them smaller works, Hollywood has created a system in which female composers simultaneously are given credits that are deemed not high profile enough to be hired for major works, and are denied the opportunity to work on such high profile productions solo. One classic example of this is Shirley Walker, who mentored the likes of Hans Zimmer and Danny Elfman, both of whom lack classical training, and yet she could never break into the top-tier movies that she was helping men with. She became only the second woman to earn a solo credit for a score in 1992 with Memoirs of an Invisible Man. Since then, women have continuously pushed the boundaries and limitations set upon them. Rachel Portman made history when she became the first woman to win an Oscar for Best Musical or Comedy Score with Emma in 1996, and she's gone on to write scores including The Cider House Rules, The Duchess, A Dog's Purpose, and Bessie, the latter of which she became the first woman to win a Primetime Emmy Award for Outstanding Musical Composition for a Limited Series, Movie, or Special, and only the second woman nominated since the award's beginning in 1955. In 1976, Angela Morley became the first transgender woman to be nominated for an Academy Award for her score for The Little Prince. Catherine Bostick, composer of the scores of Dear White People, Toni Morrison, The Pieces I Am, and Clemency, became the first female African-American member of the Academy of Motion Picture Arts and Sciences in 2016, 89 years after its formation. Afro-Indigenous musician Tamar Kali has frequently collaborated with Dee Reese to create somber and evocative scores that highlight characters in her monologue, such as can be seen with her scores from Mudbound, Pariah, and Shirley. She often incorporates her own vocals. In Shirley, she uses 3 distinct vocal lines to represent the 3 main characters, allowing distant, far-off voices to serve as echoes and influence each other. Mika Levi gained recognition in 2016 by employing similar methods of displaying characters' emotions through music through her stunning composition for Jackie. The score is full of dissonance, grand crescendos and decrescendos, and scoops that perfectly highlight the intense mental grief of the First Lady. Music supervisor Randall Poster calls the soundtrack elemental to the storytelling. It's not a companion, it's the marrow of the narrative. Articles call her one of the most original artists working in the UK today, and intensely unconventional. So how did such a masterpiece, which was nominated for an Academy Award for Best Original Score, making Levi only the fifth woman to ever be nominated for the award, lose to La La Land, a Hollywood heyday regurgitation with the notoriously underperforming vocals? Icelandic cellist and composer Hildur Guðnadóttir has gained great recognition in recent years for her innovative scores for Journey's End, Mary Magdalene, and Chernobyl, the latter of which used sounds that came almost exclusively from an actual nuclear power plant. Guðnadóttir recorded room tones, machinery, and door creakings so that the music would be the voice of the radiation, creating an eerie, intense sound that was true to the nature of the tragedy of Chernobyl. But she is perhaps most known for composing the Joker soundtrack. Guðnadóttir actually wrote most of the score before the filming began, inspired by the screenplay and fascinated with the emotional side of this character. Her score went on to inspire Joaquin Phoenix in his interpretation of the character. Guðnadóttir won a Primetime Emmy Award, a Grammy, and a BAFTA for Chernobyl. And with Joker, she became the first woman to win an award for Best Original Score at the Oscars, Golden Globe, and BAFTA ceremonies. So what work is being done to mend this strikingly obvious gap between male and female composers? Well, the Alliance for Women Film Composers was founded in 2014 to increase the visibility of women composers active in media scoring. They now have around 400 members and hold live concerts to promote the work of female composers. Workshops such as the ASCAP Film Scoring Workshop and the Sundance Institute Film Music Program have created spaces for women to gain access to the industry, and Universal Pictures started its Film Music Composer Initiative to find talented women and people of color in 2018. But British composer Carrie Andrew suggests the initiative to get women in the industry should begin much earlier. If girls are presented with examples of successful female creators in all genres, she says, they might view composition as a viable profession for themselves. This goes back to our original image of what a composer is. If we keep only teaching our children about male composers throughout history like Bach or Beethoven, rather than incorporating works from Hildegard, Clara Schumann, and Amy Beach, we'll keep seeing little girls who shy away from the world of composition. And we need to keep supporting the women who do find success in such a gendered field. Guðnadóttir put it perfectly in her acceptance speech at the 2020 Oscars, saying, "To the girls, to the women, to the mothers, to the daughters who hear the music bubbling within, please speak up. We need to hear your voices."